And it's a good night to worship. It's a good night to praise the Lord. It's a good night to sing His praises. It's a good night. It's a good night to proclaim His goodness. It's a good night to say, Lord, You are King. You are Lord of Lords. You are King of Kings. You know, it's a good night just to fellowship. Fellowship with one another, but fellowship with the Lord. Fellowship with the King of Kings. Whoa. That's what I say. Yay, God. Yay, God. Yay, God. Yay, God. Yay, God. Yay, God. Lord, we come before You with thanksgiving. We come before You with praise. We honor Your holy name. We honor You. You are holy, worthy, above all we could ask or think, higher than the highest. Lord, no matter, you are prominent King Jesus. Jesus!
Jesus, where you are, fear turns into praises. And where you are, no heart's left unchanged. So come, move, just throw my mind to the river. Worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you.
Come on.
Move, the outcast finds a family. When you move, the orphan finds a home. Lord, here we are. Lord, teach us to love mercy. With humble hearts, we bow down at your throne.
See now.
Oh, so come, move, and justice roll on like a river. Worship turn into revival.
victory. Come on.
Justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you. Lead us back to your heart. Lead us back to your heart, Jesus. Lead us back to your heart. There is a name who reigns without contention, whose power can't be questioned or contained. With humble fame, he rules the earth and heavens, and glory knows no measure or refrain. And it's bursting past the borderlines of space. Jesus, throned upon the praises of our hearts. Jesus, you're the King and you're the center of it. Triumph of his
this, Lord. Jesus.
Jesus. You're the King in your
center of it all. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. Come on, somebody declare. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord.
Oh, Jesus.
Press into your face tonight. Just want to press in, Lord. Take all the burdens, Lord. Take all the burdens off of us tonight. Yes, Jesus. Take all the burdens off. Let freedom come.
Lord, your love is extravagant. It's endless. It's forever. Oh.
just how far you go to say you love us, to say you love us, to say you love us, just to say that you left us.
For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
How many are ready to give Jesus glory tonight? Come on.
You are worthy of it all. High and lifted up tonight.
Somebody say, Jesus is worthy. Yes, Lord.
I'm just not talking. I know he's not used to that. Of the incense before the Father. And we actually are allowed to be the fragrance of Christ. That there's an exchange and it's supernatural. We don't have much to do with it except our agreement and our worship. But it draws the attention of the Father. And what draws the attention of the Father, he'll be in our midst. And he comes. And he settles. He moves in with affection. One way that the Father's really been messing me up lately is, you know, I have to get a thought and it just sits in my brain for months sometimes. It's that place of meditation. See, the world took that word from the church. And there's a place of meditation that not only is God the healer, but he wants to. He wants to. He wants to be in your life. He wants to be so real in your life that you do emit the fragrance of Christ just because he's allowed to hang around with you. And he desires, see, he doesn't do anything without us in this world. The Great Commission is more explanation than we understand. It's an opportunity to walk in fellowship with the one that releases upon us, and he tells us, go into all the world. It's an assignment. But it's his desire. He wasn't just bossing us around. He was giving us an idea of what it would look like. And what a privileged people we are to go into all of the world and to represent Jesus Christ and to look like him and to bring him glory and honor and to exalt his name, that he would just settle in your life and just move in. How many realize he's just moved in? He's just moved in. and he occupies every room in the house. And then he's worthy of it all. I just praise you, Jesus. We glorify your name. You are amazing. And we love you and we honor you and we bless you in Jesus' mighty name. It just gets gooder and gooder. Gooder and gooder and... Do you want right here? You want right there? What? Here, because you're short. Yes. Come up here. Let's see how short you are. This is Rebecca Treat. Woo! Yes. You're not that short. See if you wear heels. Pretend. See, there you are. There you are. So this is Rebecca Treat. And we are going to be blessed tonight because she's going to bring the word to us. And, you know, this house is really, really amazingly blessed with so many people that have diligently given themselves to the Word of God. And we're able to hear what that message is tonight. And so, Rebecca, I just thank you for your willingness to do this. And I told her earlier, just have fun. You know, that's half of it right there as she releases what God has put on her heart tonight. So thank you, Rebecca.
Thank you, Pastor Christy. Usually she has me do 10-minute nuggets, and the last time she talked to me, she said, well, you're actually going to be the one speaking. I'm like, there's no one else? She's like, nope, it's you. So I thank you, Pastor Christy, for letting me do this. As always, my nuggets are a little unusual, and this message is no exception. It is unique, and a lot of you know my testimony, and my testimony will be the starting of this message. The Lord gave me this word last June, and he will not let it go. I was going to try to do something else, and he's like, nope, you're doing this message. And I'm like, okay. So I pray that what you hear from me and how it is said that it comes from Jesus, it does not come from me. These are his words. This is how he wanted me to say it to you. Normally, I have an outline. I actually have a manuscript, so I don't forget every little nugget that he gave me to tell you. So don't copy me on this for those of you that speak in the future. I would be getting bad grades at school for this right now, so don't do that. But it's how I had to write it out because he just kept giving me more and more and more. So the title of my message is The Power of God's Word. And in recent messages, Pastor Christy has spoken about how religion is very cruel and it's very cold. And a lot of times it will literally, as she brought her bat to church, religion will bump you on the head with a bat, or it'll want you to bump yourself with a hat, or bat, sorry. So I have experience with that. I was in a very legalistic religion, and I am so familiar with that bat, and my bat was huge, and I'm hoping Rebecca can post this picture up, but we have a picture of the bat that was used on me when I was growing up. Let's see if she can put it up. There it is. It's the biggest bat that I could find, literally. The religion I was in did not believe in Jesus as God. There was a lot of twisted information with it. And so we had a very big bat, or I did at the time. As a child, I could only read children's books that were written by the religion, and some of the images were frightening because they believed that the world's going to end. And so I don't have pictures of those right now. I felt like the Lord said, nix that picture. But basically, it's of earthquakes and all kinds of stuff and people screaming and yelling and children screaming and yelling. And I was taught that if I didn't obey what their Bible said or their rules said, this would happen to me. So that's how I grew up. I really felt like the Bible was just a book of rules and regulations. Lord's heart was never there. I never knew the Lord's heart. His love and his compassion was definitely not there. And when I left the religion, I just literally left with the clothes on my back. And I lost all my family at the time. I lost my friends. I even had legal battles because the father of my son, my ex-husband at the time, wanted my son to be raised in that religion. So he was trying to get primary custody of my son. So as you can see, I was going through a lot of things. And then the Lord, fast forward, put me in a spirit-filled church. And I found myself at the altar giving my life to Christ. Pastor Les laughs, I cry. So bear with me here. It was so transformational because it's very rare for someone from my religion, and I apologize for not saying the name, but I have to do this for legal situation as far as I don't want them coming after me, but it's very rare for someone to come out of this religion and become a Christian. Usually when they do, they're so angry at God, they just forget about God and they go in a very dark place. And yet the Lord came to me and showed himself as a light. And he started removing the legalism and showing me that the Bible that was written by my past religion had taught me some things that were twisted to how the real Bible was written. I was trying to understand what God could do for me by reading the correct Bible, but at the same time, even though I'd become a Christian, I was still dealing with all these legal battles and being ousted from my family and friends at the time. Well, somehow, by God's grace, it's all a big blur, I went to enroll in the Colorado Christian University and in Colorado when I lived there at the time. I hadn't met my husband James, just so you know, so I was single at the time, and I got accepted. They gave me the curriculum, and I saw tons of Bible classes that were in there. You would think I'd be excited, and I kind of was, but I was terrified at the same time because I knew that I hadn't learned the Bible correctly, and here I was going into a class that was a university setting. So my first class that I took was twice a week, and it was the Old Testament class. I was so scared that I even emailed the professor and let him know my background and told him, you know, I may not say too much the first few classes because I don't know if what's going to come out of me is right, and so I'd rather just listen and take it all in. And he wrote me back and said, that's fine, Rebecca, we understand. So I walked into class, and I was, at the time, this was in my early 40s, I was the oldest female on campus, so all the kids were my son's age. They were in their late teens, early 20s that were in class with me. Some of them were pastor's kids, some of them were missionary kids, or some were just kids that had grown up all their life as a Christian. The professor started asking that day some very simple questions, which surprised me, like, I want to get a gauge of where we're at here, so tell me the story about Jonah and the whale. Tell me the story about David and Goliath. Tell me the story about Adam and Eve. Just simple things. And pretty much the students didn't want to answer any of the questions. He was so surprised that he started to get really angry, and I thought, great, this is not looking well for me right now, that's for sure. And his response was, you know what? And this was maybe 30 minutes into a 2 to 3 hour class. Let's just stop right here. We're done. And I was like, uh-oh. He said, let's wait till next class. So next class, I come into a dark classroom. And I thought, okay, what's going on? Everybody sat down. I remember there were some boys around me that had these huge jackets because we were in the springtime and we had just had a snowstorm. And so they were all bundled up around and everything. And I was like, okay, it's dark. What's going on? So the professor said, well, boys and girls, we're going to have our own come to Jesus session right now. And he put a video on, and this is the first picture I saw. And if Rebecca can put that up. Mind you, we are in a university for a bachelor's degree. And I heard all these kids moan and groan and start slinking in their desks. And I was like, what is that? I had never in my life seen that. I'm like, those are vegetables. What are vegetables? What? It's a cartoon. What is that? So he proceeded to play the entire 30-minute cartoon. Now, I'm not sure we were having trouble back there. I'm not going to play you the 30-minute cartoon. But what I was wanting to play you was the trailer of this cartoon. And I'm hoping that they're able to put that up for me, I think, on YouTube. And there's a reason for my madness on this. There it goes. See if there's any sound to it. If there's no sound, just watch. As you notice, many of them are mini asparaguses, gourds, and they're doing the story of David and Goliath. And there's peas. Apologize for no sound. But basically, Larry the cucumber was feeling very unworthy and didn't think that he could do his job. And so David, being the mini asparagus, they told the story of David and Goliath, and there's Goliath right there, the giant pickle, which is why it is called David and the Giant Pickle. So at the end of the cartoon, the lesson was that Larry the cucumber was moved by the story of David and Goliath, and they used the scripture of Matthew 19:26, with God, all things are possible for him. So while this 30-minute cartoon was playing, I got saved in a spirit-filled church. I'm not sure about the kids around me, but all of a sudden, I sensed the Holy Spirit come into the room as the cartoon was playing. I was watching the cartoon, but I could see Jesus in front of the cartoon, and he was showing me his personality that I'd never seen before. He showed me that even though this was a children's cartoon, it was showing God's love. Nothing was impossible for me, whether I was going through school or fighting whatever battle I was going through. No giant could overtake me. I started going into a different dimension up in heaven, and I saw Jesus, and I saw the Bible, and he started showing me this word here isn't meant to scare you. It's not words and regulations or rules. It is to prepare me and to see himself immensely in him. He wanted me to have that childlike faith that I would have no doubt of the power of his word and the Holy Spirit. When the cartoon ended and the lights turned back on, the students, I saw them all, were mortified. By the time the cartoon was done, they were under the desk, they had jackets over them. They were so embarrassed, they couldn't believe that a university professor had just showed them VeggieTales. I was in heaven with Jesus still, so much that when the professor asked, well, boys and girls, what lesson did we learn today? I felt Jesus pulling my hand up. Now, mind you, I was not going to say a word. And my hand went all the way up to the top, and I saw the Lord. And the only thing that came out of my mouth was, Goliath was a pickle. And that's how I looked. And the whole class roared with laughter. And then I look at the professor. He was not roaring with laughter. I had ruined his whole disciplinary action he was trying to do. He was not amused at all. Well, after class, I got hooked. So after class, I went up to him and I said, what else you got? And he's like, what else I got of what, Rebecca? Of the cartoons. There's got to be more. There's got to be more. I want to know what else God is telling me. And he's like, well, this one I borrowed from my children, so I can't really loan it to you. I'm like, well, the library must have them. I mean, I didn't care where I was or what I was doing. I had to get my hands on them. It was like I was a sponge wanting more of Jesus' word. And he says, well, you could always go ask the girls next door that are learning to be kindergarten teachers. They might have it there. I'm like, I'm going to go and find it. What was God doing to me at that time? He was showing me that his word was alive. It can redeem you. It can bring revival in no matter what stage of life you are in. The scriptures that I'm going to be focusing on is two scriptures. The first one is 2 Timothy 3:16. And I'm going to be, the Bible I brought was not the right version, so I'm going to be reading it to you from the ESV, and I think we have it up there. 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. The phrase God breathed in Greek is theopneustos. This is the same breath that God breathed into Adam in Genesis 2, and Adam became a living soul. So the Bible that we all hold is God breathed. In Hebrews, the second scripture is Hebrews 4, chapter 4, verse 12. And I think we have it up there. It says, for the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit and of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Can you say that, and can I still say that about God's word? Has it impacted your life to the point where it is living and active and God-breathed? I'm going to speak about three people in the Bible from the Old Testament. Now, it's interesting because they did not have the Bible that we have now. They knew God through history and through promises and what he has done in the past for their people. And the first person I'm going to bring up there, I'm using visuals just to make it a little bit more so you can see, is Abraham. In Genesis chapter 15, Abraham was afraid because he had just conquered four armies, and he was worried that they would get back to him. Abraham couldn't sleep at night. He was tossing and turning, and he couldn't dream. So God gave to him in a vision a shield. And the Hebrew word in Genesis used for shield is mahen, meaning all-surrounding shield. It was a 360-degree protection. So when we are afraid or in trouble, please know with this story, it teaches us that the Lord surrounds us with a shield. He surrounds us with songs of deliverance. Can you sleep well at night? Or have your thoughts become the loudest at night? When you can't sleep, you can read God's breathed word. And it will become alive and become a 360-degree shield that will completely protect you. What's interesting is that Abraham was not perfect. But because he was God's, that is why he gave him the word. The second person is Daniel. And I think we have a picture. In Daniel chapter 6, evil men plotted against Daniel. And due to his obedience to God, we know the story, he was thrown into the lion's den. And yet, in Daniel chapter 6, verse 23, part B of that verse, it says, so Daniel then was taken out of the den, and no injury whatever was found on him because he believed in his God. Sometimes there are challenges in our life where what do you do when you don't know what to do? Believe me, God is working things out for you. Because as we learn from Daniel, all he did was believe in the Lord and know that the Lord would save him. The third person I want to talk about is Esther, and she's near and dear to my heart because when I got saved, the Lord said I was Esther, and I'm still working that journey out. But I ended up even starting a ministry, Esther's of Today, in Colorado that empowers women to be like Esther. She was a descendant of the tribe of Benjamin, which had been part of the kingdom of Judah. Her ancestors were among the Jews who had been captive to Babylon nearly 100 years earlier. But she was a very inspiring woman of faith and principle because she was willing to risk her life for the life of others. She knew the miracles that God had done for the children of Israel, so she knew she had to rely and put her trust in God and to know with conviction and clarity that God was missing, even though at the time, like I said, they did not have the Bible like we did, and so God, in a sense, was hidden. Esther 4:14, we've read the scripture before, but I will read it again. It says, "For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this?" Esther was reluctant, but she knew what she was taught by her uncle Mordecai, that God had promised that the Jews would be a great nation. She knew she had to depend on her Lord, and he was responsible for her way out. So as that scripture showed, 3 days later, she put on, and that picture I had shown you too, she put on her royal robes and opened up the doors and approached the king's court. And this was very life-risking because as a woman going into the court without permission and also them knowing she was not a Jew, thinking that she was not a Jew, she would have to unveil her identity to the king, which would be punishable for death. The story narrates that the fear in Esther's heart as she walked toward the throne room, she had no doubt. And she trembled to the king. And what happened? If we continue reading the story of Esther, the king was pleased with her. And he reached out his rod in hand to her. And they, through all kinds of other things happening, she was able to save her nation. God is sovereign in that story. He is in control of all things, and nothing will stop his plans. Again, these people did not have the Bible that we have. Can you imagine if they did? What kind of revival would have happened? So, what is our responsibility? Are we reading the Bible and these real-life stories to strengthen our faith? Most of the time, our lives can be routine, but what if a challenge blindsides you, or you have the biggest fight of your life? What will you do when you face that for such a time as this moment? I found a quote from Bill Johnson from Bethel that states this really well. It says, "The best way to enjoy reading the Bible is to do it in partnership with the Holy Spirit. Learn to recognize the presence. Read it till it comes alive. If I feel like I'm lacking insight on prayer or the motivation to pray, I will start reading on that subject throughout the scripture, even though I'm not hungry or interested." As we read the Old Testament, we see how God was faithful. And yet we can interpret it under the light of the new covenant. In the Old Testament, we see God's personality, but in the New Testament, we see the new covenant that we are no longer under law, but under grace. And so you can't help but prosper when you read it. All things are held together. There's always peace and harmony. I found this one on social media, this one picture that illustrates exactly where my heart is with this message. Life is peaceful when you rest on the promises of God. So if you find yourself weak, spend some time in the Word. It has God's breath. It's like an oxygen tank. He cares for you. You are His priority. And these words in the Bible are so precious. Don't rush through them. The more you read, the more you see Jesus, and the more you'll discover what his perspective is for you. You will see as Jesus sees, because Jesus' reality is like none of ours. I'm not saying we need to watch VeggieTales, okay? Somehow the Lord used that because he knew I'd never seen it before. But when we can't sleep or we have those night seasons of life, if we take that Bible that is God-breathed and we read it with prayer, if you have a prayer language, you read it with that, or even praising God, because there's freedom in praising God, as we just sang, which removes the darkness. You will experience a turnaround in your situation because the Lord will start to give you revelation. You could write some things in your Bible that later on, when you see them, they will bless you over and over again. Sometimes when I write or highlight something in my Bible, it'll pop out just at the time when I need it. One thing the Lord put on my heart with this message is, what do you do if you don't have the Bible in front of you? We see the countries with a lot of persecution. What if that comes here? Then what are we going to do? We have to know that the Holy Spirit will call to memory, if we have read the Bible, the hidden word in our heart, and with anointed prayer, it will get us through this trial. In my ministry in the past, I've encouraged ladies to use art journaling to create verse cards, picking out key words, asking themselves questions to commit them to memory. But again, the goal is not to memorize, it's to hide the word in our heart. We will be able to partner with the Holy Spirit, because the word of God is alive and powerful as it unveils Jesus for us now in this modern time, so that our lives can be transformed. I found this prayer that I want. Normally I don't read prayers, but I found this one. It was perfect. So I'm not asking anybody to stand, but I would like you to bow your heads and close your eyes as I read this. I pray that you grant, Jesus, to everyone here right now, the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of you, and that receiving revelation will be their craving. See afresh what is revealed in the scriptures by your Holy Spirit. I pray that everyone is reminded when they open their Bible from now on that they will see you, they will see Jesus. They will see how the scriptures were written for our sakes, and they will receive life, health, and freedom. In Jesus' name, amen. Pastor Christy. I asked Pastor Les to come up here if he felt led to. So I will now let Jesus continue leading.
Father, we thank you, God, that you made a way for us, that we can come to you anytime, day or night. You made a way for me to enter the holy place. You made a way for me to enter the holy place. You made enter the holy place. I am yours, you are mine, and we'll be together forever. I am yours, and you are mine, and we'll be together forever.
The other morning, Jesus came up to the table that I was praying at. And I was sitting down on the bench, and I just heard him say to me, "Stand up. Put some music on. I want to dance with you." And of course, I reluctantly, I was like, "Really? You're going to make me get up and dance with a bunch of air?" If somebody was to film me, they'd think I was crazy. But the minute that I stood up and embraced him and we just start to sway, I just got wrecked. Church, he reaches out to us more than we know. And the things that we think silly, like dancing with nobody, but in my mind, I'm dancing with the King of Kings. You made a way for us to enter the holy place. You made a way for us to dance with you and see your face. I am yours, you are mine, and we'll be together forever. I am yours, and you are mine, and we'll be together forever. Forever. It's the greatest love story ever told. Amen. Let's all stand. And just sing that with me. You made a way.
You made a way for me to enter the holy place. I am yours, you are mine, and we'll be together forever. Just dance with him. I am yours, you are mine, and we'll be together forever. Forever, I am yours, Jesus. You are mine, and we'll dance together forever.
Just come. Jesus says, just come. Just come to him. Come to him. Cast all your cares. Cast all your burdens on him. Amen. How many love Jesus tonight? Let's give him praise. Amen. Well, tonight's been really good, you guys. Rebecca, let's give Rebecca a hand. She was so nervous. I think she came in like five or six times before she
came preaching. She's like, you know, is this and that and that? And I'm like, girl, just do what you do. It'll be great. Well, hug somebody's neck that you don't know, okay? Challenge yourself, amen? I know that, how many are visitors tonight? You guys visitors? Come on, let's welcome them. Nice to have you guys tonight. Nice to have you guys. Get to know them, come on. Thank you, Jesus. We just thank you. You're just dismissed. Be blessed in Jesus' name. I am yours.